What is up, my Canadian cousins, my very good friends? So, yeah, obviously, I am returning very soon after I did the first video about the Tragically Hip to this subject. And I am very aware of all the wonderful suggestions you guys have been giving me about other Canadian artists that aren't very well known to Americans, both, you know, traditional music, more modern music, etc. But I'm returning to this subject so soon after I did it for a couple of reasons, and I'd like to explain them to you. Number one, I just really like the music. And I kind of feel like, you know, I'm exactly the right age for somebody who would have come of age to this music, because they started in the mid 80s. I was a teenager, got really big in the 90s. And, you know, those were years where I was in college and grad school and, you know, ultimately started my professional life and started a family throughout the late 90s, you know, 2000s and, you know, on and on, you know, it resonates with me. And I have to confess, I have listened to a ton since the last time I saw you guys. I just couldn't help it. I'm like the kid who has to sneak to look at the Christmas presents before Christmas morning. But oftentimes I listen to music in the background because I'm a busy guy and I've got a lot of things to do. And so, you know, I can't really dive very deeply into the lyrics. And I know Gord Downie is known for being somewhat of a poet, and his lyrics very much speak to the Canadian experience. And so that's really the second reason why I'm doing that, is because this is such a cultural specific band to Canada. Although, you know, of course they're rock music, and notwithstanding the lyrics, if they were, you know, an American band, I wouldn't know the difference, but they had Canada in the core of who they were. Also, you know, I'm very touched about the ending. It's a unique situation, and it's bittersweet. It's extremely sad that Gord's life ended too early. You know, a man relatively the age I am now, with children like I have now, and I just feel like it's extremely sad, and he just had so much more to contribute. But sweet because you knew that that was the last concert. You know, you don't never know when a band is going to end. And I watched the documentary about that last tour, and you know what struck me is just how cathartic it was, I think, for Gord and for the band and the Canadian people, knowing that this was going to be their end, that they were ending as friends without controversy, that they were ending not because they wanted to, but because they were forced to. But they did it on their terms. They did it with a guy who was sick and struggling a bit, but you know, never gave up. And when he stumbled for lyrics, the fans were singing the lyrics for him, and it was just extremely touching. And so that brings me, really segues into the last reason I'm doing it again, is because of how you all feel about this band, that they touched the hearts of Canadians, and that their story was able to end the way it did, is just sort of like a once in a millennia cultural story. I don't know, I can't quite explain, but I don't have to explain it to you. You all know exactly what I'm talking about. I'm the one who's learning about it right now. So also how Gord spent his last years in doing the project, The Secret Path. Yeah, and you know, finally my little self-indulgence with my drum intro there. So I'm going to be reacting to Bobcaygeon, and of course I've heard the song. I couldn't have played the drum part that I did without listening to the song quite carefully. You know, but I did listen to it, you know, over the course of like 20 minutes to just sort of by ear get the approximation of the drum groove down, the timing down, when fills were coming in and when cymbal crashes were. I didn't see any sheet music, so I'm not doing precisely what their drummer did. I'm doing an approximation of what he did to fit the song, because I would really have to spend time to learn it all precisely, and I just wanted to have fun playing along with it and learn a close approximation of what it was for you guys, but for me too. So just to sort of show you how much fun I'm having with this music. So yeah, I'm going to be reacting to that, but not before I do segments from interviews by Peter Mansbridge of Gord Downie. I want you to know too, I'm not ignoring the rest of the band. I, on my own, watched a lengthy interview with the band members from when they played the Junos after Gord had passed, and it was a very touching interview. So I'm not ignoring the rest of the band, but you know, Gord was the front man, and unfortunately his life came to an end, and it came to an end a way in which, you know, he went out still doing good for this world. I chose these interviews that Peter Mansbridge did because I very much like and respect Peter. We're going to look at some segments of interviews, and then we're going to get into the song. So stick with me on this ride, and let's enjoy this.
I'm a stranger. You can't see me. I am a stranger. Do you know what I mean?
That voice, it is unmistakable.
I am the stranger.
So is yours, Peter.
I've known Gord Downie for about 25 years. I'm a fan, devastated like so many others about the news of his cancer. Amazed at his performance through the summer's final tour. He's big on hugs and kisses, wants them with friends and strangers alike, on greeting and on parting.
I noticed that in the long time running documentary that I watched. I thought that was so sweet, and actually, in no pretense, grown man kissing his bandmates on the lips, whispering in their ears why he loves them. You know, why not? Forget social convention. If not, then when?
But aside from all that, he's still Gord Downie, adored by his fans and fighting to make his mark on Canada. In his latest project, he's aiming to bridge the gap between Indigenous and non-Indigenous Canadians. It's his legacy project, The Secret Path.
This is what I want to do. Nothing else really matters to me.
That's from the beginning of The Secret Path, because I said I watched the first 10 minutes of it, and I'm just really excited to get to it.
We sat down in his Toronto rehearsal studio to talk about life, music, the Tragically Hip, and his legacy.
Okay. A lot of people want to know how you're doing. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. And I said that on purpose. You know, I'm doing good. I am.
Instead of doing well, he said, I'm doing good, because that is what he's doing with the Secret Path project.
It's tricky, but I have beautiful friends, you know. I've been so lucky, you know, living here in Toronto and being in the business I'm in. I'm a very lucky guy.
Well, people have, going through this, have good days and bad days.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah, that's me. Check.
This is a good day?
This is a good day, man, seeing you especially.
When you see people now, you want a hug?
I do.
And a kiss?
Yeah.
Why is that important to you now?
That was happening before, though, all this, yeah? Strangely, yeah. Yeah. Mm. My life was changing, and I felt everyone that hung in there with me all these years were still there. They didn't write me off or anything like that. And they could have. And
interesting. So that was even before he was diagnosed. He was starting to just buck social conventions and say, yeah, nothing wrong with it. Feeling love for people.
And my brothers taught a lot of men.
Feeling appreciation. Feeling appreciation for people.
You mentioned about how you helped get you and your brothers and your family helped get your dad to the door.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see the door?
Right now?
Hmm.
Like, no. Not, no. I mean, it's just the door where you can say, it's cool, man. You can go. Everything's cool. Don't worry.
Are you in pain?
I don't think this is going to be a pain issue thing. Like I said, I think I got lucky with this one.
Got lucky with it. What an attitude to have, just thinking, you know, what other people suffer through, even though he knows that he will be shown the door, that the door is coming, as he was saying.
So we go through a summer where you and the Hip are on tour. Mm-hmm. And it's an amazing tour. With millions of Canadians watching on television, and live streaming, and what have you. What was happening there? Why do you think that was? Why the country reacted the way it did?
I'm going to pause a second because that's, you know, kind of the key question that I want to learn.
You know, was it simply because they right. saw you slipping away?
Right. I think they tune in thinking, what am I going to see? Not like, how bad is he going to be or what? Well, maybe. Maybe a bit of everything. A bit of, oh, I love that band, or I saw them once, or what's the singer going to, I don't know.
My thoughts are that I really doubt that it was about, you know, oh, what kind of condition is he going to be in, or, you know, what are we going to see? I don't think there was a morbid curiosity about it, as though it were some, you know, watching some train wreck happen. I don't think anybody wanted that. I mean, I would say most sane people wouldn't have wanted that. I think it was about a band that had existed for so long that was very important to Canada, and having the unique knowledge beforehand that this show was going to be it. So, you know, the last chance, the last goodbye, and not a goodbye of, you know, petty squabbles in the bands, you know, have to come in through separate doors because they all hate each other. A goodbye that was forced on them because of the unfortunate roll of the dice with Gord's health. And it was a way for the country to know and to celebrate all together this band that you all love. I think that's probably what it was about, right?
What do you think the Hip meant to those millions of followers that you had? There was a connection between the Hip and Canada.
I mentioned it a lot in lyrics. Is that sort of what you're getting? Yeah. Hmm. But never, and I don't say this to my pride, but never nice. Never totally like, aren't we the best? Never. Because, I don't mean to hurt anyone's feelings, but as a kid growing up, like, what is it about this country that isn't, it's not a country? What is it? Can't tell. You know, we got to figure out a way to really help out these our friends up north, you know? I'm not like putting it all on my death, but it's put me in a position where I can actually get some attention. As I said something at the show mm-hmm. that really clung.
And we gotta be a country. It's gonna take us 100 years to figure out what the hell went on up there.
Yeah, I mean, oftentimes artists who have a platform like this, particularly famous actors and musicians, they are the widespread voice of social conscience. Some of them are trite. Some of them maybe are insincere and are doing it for publicity. Some talk about it superficially, but don't put their money where their mouth is. But there are some who are exceptional and sincere and mean it and use the power of their public platform to do good. And this is sincere. And so the fact that any artist may sing about the ills and the woes of society doesn't necessarily mean that they don't love their country and that the listener understands that and loves them for it and feels a pride in their nation, not for the things that are critical within the art, but for the artist being critical and for everybody to be able to recognize it one of
52 line.
Why did this become something that you became so interested in and been so concerned about and wanting to tell this story?
Well, my brother Mike gave him this sort of piece, one from the McLean's in 67, about a year after it had happened in 66. And it's just a basically sort of thumbnail description of a boy running away from the
residential school.
Yeah, that you're talking about, and trying to get home.
On a secret path, the one that nobody knows, and I'm moving fast on the path nobody knows.
This is the best thing I've ever done. And by best, I just mean it helps my heart a little bit. This is what I want to do. Nothing else really matters to me.
Hi. Good morning.
How you doing?
I'm okay. How are you doing today?
Pretty good.
Good. Yeah.
A friend of mine, Kev Drew, asked me one day to make a record with him. He just wanted to make a record. And I said, I
wonder if Gord Downie was at all thinking about or inspired by Terry Fox. I don't know, I'm just
seeing good, power. But I don't think I have any songs. But the weird thing is that I'd been writing about Charlie. So we made a record, and it's an attempt to capture the feeling somehow of trying to get home. I mean, we can think about how little we think about up there.
What nation was Charlie a part of? Just very curious. There.
But it's unbelievable. And yet their resilience, their ability to survive that, but they're still, like they say, there's seven generations to go to fix. These things don't just get fixed now up there. You know, a lot of places not getting better like we would expect. Mm-hmm. You know, well, everything gets better, like getting a little bit worse. And so now we have the chance to build something that will allow us down here and them up there to become, to realize that makes us a country. That's 150. Well, the last 150 years aren't as much worth celebrating as we think, but the new 150 years can be a year of building an actual nation, you know, with, like, imagine if they were part of us and we them, like how incredibly cool it would make us.
You know what country has done a really good job with this, and is New Zealand with Maori. And they still have a ways to go. I've studied this a bit because I'm very interested in Maori culture. But by and large, when you look at New Zealand, they've done a really good job in taking the two distinct cultures and trying to make up for the things, for the sins that they visited upon the Maori culture, and adopt, you know, much of the Maori culture into the larger New Zealand culture. You know, a lot of them, their greeting even just becomes kia ora, you know, which is obviously a Maori word. So they've done a very good job at becoming, at taking two distinct cultures and trying to meld it into something that is one.
You know, and that's what's missing as we celebrate donuts and hockey over and over and over and over again.
I guess it's the question that I have is, when you say, we didn't know about this, nobody told us about this, there were attempts to tell those stories, but there was this question about, you know, how interested we were in knowing this was even a problem. It all centers around the question about, are we racist in our attitudes towards Indigenous people?
I don't think we are. Racist, no way. Just no exposure. This is, again, a chance at a whole different world.
Certainly, historically, there was racism. I mean, this is no question. Policies of the British, of the United States, of Canada towards indigenous people were absolutely racist. No doubt about it. But I think in modern times, most people are not racist. And, you know, but they're unfortunately, there sometimes tends to be, and I think this is what he's getting at, out of sight, out of mind, there tends to be indifference towards the suffering of others. I mean, they could be of the same race, but it may be a different class of people. You know, here there's some indifference to some of the poorest people in the United States are white in the Appalachia Mountains. But they're out of sight, out of mind, and people don't think about them that much. And so there's indifference. I think that's the problem that he's getting at.
President, I don't think we're racist at all. I think we would love to have this added to our country.
I had wanted to tell my brother's story. I wanted his life to mean something. I had no idea how I was going to do that. But I trusted, I knew that something would come about in time. You know, who would ever thought? Tragically Hip.
Everybody, if they just hear his story, will, you know, I think that's what people who hear, see his story, read it, they do. I've heard that a lot. People that just can't shake it.
Are you resigned to the direction this is heading?
I am resigned to the direction this is heading, yes. I am. I really am. And because I can see it and feel it doing some, not doing some good, but it's creating, it's creating something. And
an opportunity,
I guess, and they just don't come around too often. And
does that make it easier to deal with what you're going through?
Yes, for sure.
Until the next time, Gord.
I love you. I'm just gonna say that.
Love you too.
A little kiss.
Heavy stuff, my friends. Let's take a minute. Okay, we're back. Before I start the song. So I'm gonna... needed a minute after that. Before I start the song, I just want to say that I am going to pay very close attention to the lyrics, and let's see if I can decipher the poetry and meaning of this song. Anyway, let's get to it, my friends. Bobcaygeon is a small town in Ontario. saw the constellation, could have revealed himself in time. Small town, you'll see the stars a lot better than... City, Toronto, I believe, and there's somebody who's very important to him who lives in Bobcaygeon.
That night in Toronto, with its checkerboard floors, riding on horseback and keeping order is guard. Tell the men they couldn't hang, step to the mic and say.
So there's some kind of riot going on. He's a police officer. The voices rang with an Aryan twang. I think I saw somebody there raise their hand in that disgusting salute. Is he dealing with some kind of neo-Nazi right-wing organization here? Did something happen? Got a tough job in the big city. This is his oasis. This is his. Outro. Am I totally off base with what I'm, you know, deciphering the what this song is about? And is this based on true events? I'm backing up a second. I want to see what it said on his guitar. Same-ish the machine kills fascist. Oh, I think maybe behind his arm it says, this machine kills fascist. Freedom of expression, particularly through art and music, is the enemy of fascism. All right. Well, my friends, well. Yes, this trip I am on with a Tragically Hip is awesome. And I am glad I'm still only in the beginning of it. And I think that's where we'll leave things for today. I'll see you soon, and I'm going to have an outro of my own. All right, my friends, take care.